Hello friends, welcome back. In this video, I'm going to discuss about Git concept and its overall architecture. I have already created another video on Git basic where I just showed how you can quickly use the Git and Git commands. I also provided a cheat sheet so you can follow that. Here in this video, I'm going to discuss about overall Git architecture and its underlying concept, how it works. So we'll discuss about distributed version control system. So also we'll just quickly go through the what is the centralized version control system, and we'll compare between the centralized version control system and distributed VCS. Then we will also talk about different terminology used in distributed version control system, specifically in Git. So we have local repo. So we will discuss what is local repo, what is remote origin repo, what is branch, what is working tree, staging area, etc. And also at last we will discuss about what is commit point. So I'll try to demonstrate it using a white dashboard. Hopefully it will be useful for you. So before talking about Git architecture and underlying concept, let's discuss about history of Git first. So Linus Torvalds created the Git, who is also creator of Linux kernel. It is heard that Linus created Git over the weekend when his team actually was facing a challenge using BitKeeper, and that is where Linus took the challenge by himself and worked during the weekend and came up with a totally new version control system, which is Git, in following week. You can follow this link and you can find the overall interview which is given there, and it is really interesting. So let's talk about version control system. So nowadays Git is so popular that we always think about Git, which is a distributed version control system. In past, we usually use centralized version control system where there is a centralized repository hosted on a server somewhere, and every contributors of the team used to get connected with the central repository, that central server, and pull down all the required files, make the changes and upload it one by one. So every person needs to actually sync or resolve the merge conflict while uploading the file. So if multiple people work in a common file, then the latter person who are actually trying to upload the file in centralized repository has to manually merge the file and then upload it into the centralized repository. So in this architecture, there is a centralized repository and every contributor has their own local directory where they pull down the files and work on top of that. Obviously, it requires more collaborative approach while uploading and making changes on a common files, right? Now, most important part is there is a single point of failure. If somehow the centralized repository gets down, whether it is a server problem or network problem, then during that hour, no one will be able to collaborate at all. And even in a worst case, if the disk of the central server gets corrupted and proper backup has not been taken, then you will lose the entire history of the project. And that's why that distributed version control system comes into the picture. In the distributed version control system, we have a remote repository, which is also known as origin. And we also have multiple local mirror of that same remote repository, which is a completely replica of that remote repository, and this local repository can be created within each contributor's systems. So in distributed version control system, you can actually check out the latest snapshot of the directory, but they also fully mirror of the repository. If the server goes down, then the repository from any contributor can be copied back to the server to restore it. An interesting part is distributed system does not rely on a centralized server, right? So every checkout is a full backup of the repository. So any contributor can work on their end separately and then merge together if required. So contributor can commit changes, create branches, view logs, and perform other operations when they do not have any connection with the remote repository. So there are multiple advantages of Git. Definitely it is a free and open source. You don't have to pay for it. It is a very fast and small, so you can quickly install and use it. It is very lightweight. And there is an implicit backup, as I have just mentioned. There are multiple local repository. Any repository can be replicated with anyone. There is a very strong security architecture in place as well. Git uses secure hash algorithm. It uses public-private key authentication mechanism, so there is a complete security as well. And very important from the developer standpoint, you can quickly create n number of branches. These branches are very cheap and lightweight. You can quickly create your branch, which is a complete different development structure, I would say. So individual branch can be considered as a complete development workflow, and you have your own folder structure, file structure, and you can make any changes on that particular branch. And if required, you can also merge that particular branch with another branch as well. So let's talk about different states when you are working with the Git repository. Then you have four different states. So let's assume you want to check out the complete repository from the remote repository, which is origin of your source. And if you use Git pull, then it will actually create a mirror or replica of the complete Git repository in your local systems. So when it creates the local repository, it by default, it gives you the master branch. You can start working on master branch directly. However, it is best practice that you create your own sub branch and then start working on that. And if you are working on a particular branch, that becomes your working directory. Now then, after making any changes, if you are satisfied your changes, you need to add those files under Git tracking system. So usually you fire git add command, which puts those files under Git tracking system. And as soon as you are adding those files under Git tracking system, that means those files are within staging area. And then you can commit those changes in your local repository. So those changes will be persisted. So that means you are saving all of your changes in your local repository. And lastly, when you are satisfied with all of your commits and all of your changes, if you want, you can push or rather upload all of your changes to the remote Git repository. So these are the four different states: working directory, and then you are adding your changes to the staging area. Then if you are satisfied with your changes, then you can commit and persist the changes permanently in your local Git repository. Then you can upload your changes from your local repository, which is in your system, to the remote repository, which can be in any other server, hosted on cloud or some other on-premise system as well. So let's talk about commit point now. So let's move to the whiteboard so it will be easier for me to explain. Okay, so let's assume this is the timeline. And this is the remote repository timeline. So let's mark it as R. This is the remote repository timeline. Let's assume someone is working on this remote repository and made some changes and persisted those changes here in this point. So let's call it commit 1. So let's assume that you have this save point and you made some changes and you want to revert back to that save point. You can easily do that. So this is a save point. Like it's similar to the gaming concept, right? Like when you play a game, you want to save your progress, so you can restart from that point onwards, right? So let's assume we have a couple of save points. So let's assume someone has worked and made a couple of commit points. Let's call it C2 and then also another commit point C3, right? Now, some other team member wants to download all these changes from the remote repository. So let's assume he has created another local branch L1 and timeline for this local branch is this one. And the contributor downloaded all the repository. Now in this local repository also, as it will be a complete replica of the remote server, so we'll also have three commit points. So as it exists in the local repository, it is a complete separate repository. Let's call it C1-1, C2- and C3-. Let's assume another developer has downloaded the complete repository and we'll have three different commit points again, --1, --2, --. Now developer 1, let's call it this is for the developer 1, this is for developer 2. So now developer 1 has made some changes and committed in his local repository. So that becomes C-4. Also developer 2 has made some changes, so let's call it C-4 and C-5. Now let's assume developer 1 is satisfied with these changes and he wants to upload the changes to the remote repository. That means he will upload or use git push to upload his changes. So it will make another commit in the remote repository, which is basically C4. Now both of them created the repository from this point, right? Now let's assume developer 2 wants to upload his changes to the remote repository. Now, if he tries to upload his changes here, the remote repository will not allow these changes until and unless developer 2 sync his changes with the remote repository. That means history of this branch is not same with the remote history. That means there is a new changes in the remote repository which is not in sync with the developer 2 branch. When developer 2 tries to upload his changes to the remote repository, it will just reject that push request. So how developer 2 will be able to resolve this issue? So developer 2 needs to pull the changes from the remote repository to his local repository. So what Git will do, Git will merge all the C4 changes with the C++4 and C++5 changes and automatically create a new commit here, C++6. Now if developer 2 tries to push his changes from his local repository to the remote repository, then remote repository will allow the change and create a new commit point C5. So this is the basic concept of how multiple contributors can work together. However, the most important part is you don't have to manually merge all the changes. Git is very smart and intelligent. It can resolve all the merge requests if the contributors do not work on the same file on the same line. Otherwise, Git is so intelligent that it can resolve any kind of merge. I believe it helps you to understand what is the commit and what is the saving point, how the multiple contributors can work together. Very often people get an error while pushing changes from their local repository to the remote repository. Remote repository always rejects the push. So that means I have just explained why you are getting the reject request. You just need to pull the changes from the remote repository. Git will automatically merge and create a merge commit for you. It will give you the pointers for each file where it could not resolve any merge. And that if there is any merge conflict, it will just tell you where it is. So you just need to open those files and remove those marker and make the adjustment, whatever you necessary, you can keep it, right? And after that, you should manually commit and upload the changes in the remote repository. Let's talk about what is commit head. Now again, this is the timeline, right? Let's assume we have a repository timeline. So we have multiple commits C1, C2, C3, C4 like this, right? Now let's consider C4 is the latest commit. That means this is the head, right? Now whenever you pull or clone a complete Git repository from any other remote repository, your default branch is master and your commit is the latest commit. That means you are at the head. So let's assume you have made some changes and you are not satisfied of your changes, you want to reset it. So if you use git reset --head, it will reset all of your changes. That means it will discard all of your uncommitted changes and bring this pointer here. Now let's assume there might be a scenario that you want to use your base version from C3 instead of C4. Now if you use git reset head 1, that means the one commit before the latest commit, that means this one C3. So you can reach to this point and then you can make your changes on top of the C3 commit. In that way, you can use git reset head --2, 3 or n, any number of number of commits. Then git will reset to that particular commit. Thank you guys. If you like this video, please share and comment below so I can enhance my next videos accordingly. Thank you.